You know the story. After the non-avian dinosaurs were wiped out at the end of the Cretaceous, mammals became the primary large vertebrates and took over the planet, forcing their inferior reptilian competitors to live in the shadows. At least, that's what the executives over at Big Mammal want you to think. The truth is far more interesting. Even in the Cenozoic, the so-called Age of Mammals, large reptiles not only survived, but thrived as apex predators in a variety of environments, carving their dominance into the fossil record and complicating the simple idea of mammalian superiority. The biggest land predator in the Cenozoic, for example, wasn't a saber-toothed cat, a hyaenodont, or even a bear. It was, for all intents and purposes, a prehistoric dragon. The Sebecids were a group of Pseudosuchians, meaning they were archosaurs more closely related to crocodiles than to birds. They originated in Cretaceous Europe and were one of the lucky groups to survive the KPG extinction, finding themselves in a world where the previous rulers, non-avian dinosaurs, had vanished. They spread to South America and on both continents grew to spectacular sizes. In Eocene France, we had Dentaneosuchus. This bone-crushing predator was described in 2023 from a partial skull and some post-cranial material. Its tall, powerful head and laterally compressed teeth are those of a terrestrial hunter designed to take on big game. Based on its smaller relatives, Dentaneosuchus would have been about 6 meters long and weighed well over 1,000 kilograms, enabling it to take on 2-ton mammalian prey like Lophiodon. It also sported osteoderm armor in case it wasn't scary enough already. And speaking of awesome crocs, here's my friend Overseer to join us.
Hey Vivident, it is great to be here. Barinasuchus is more famous than its European cousin. Known from its remains in Venezuela, Peru, and Argentina, it was the apex predator in Cenozoic South America from the mid-Eocene to the mid-Miocene, a period that stretched nearly 30 million years. While only known from a partial skull, that skull is absolutely enormous. A 2016 study established its likely size range as about 6 meters long and between 1600 and 1700 kilograms, pointing out that Barinasuchus' complete skull would have likely been comparable size to that of the Tyrannosaur Displetosaurus. That is right, the Cenozoic had a reptilian apex predator that hunted on land and was nearly as big as some tyrannosaurs. The authors pointed out that even if these estimates based on length-mass relationships in modern crocodilians were 50% too high, Barinasuchus would still be in the same tier as the very largest bears. It would have feasted upon dog-to-cow-sized mammals along with practically anything else it could crush between its massive jaws.
Purussaurus brasiliensis may have been the biggest non-whale macro predator of the Cenozoic, period. This Miocene caiman is only known from skull material, but estimates range from 10 to 13 meters and 5 to 8 tons, making it the size of a large African elephant. Its teeth were conical, pointed, and serrated, perfect for both cutting flesh and crushing bone or armor. It would have used its flat, broad head to spy on large mammals from the water and ambush them, giving them a brutal end. The monster caiman's bite force was calculated between 52,000 and 69,000 newtons, making it comparable to the high-end estimates for megatheropods like Tyrannosaurus. It also lived all across South America, and would have preyed on a variety of victims, including giant turtles like Stupendemis, titanic capybaras like Josepha artagasia, other crocodilians like Gryposuchus, river dolphins, and even terror birds. As far as I know, there has never been a mammal capable of directly competing with crocodilians for the river system apex predator niche. And no, hippos do not count.
Astorgosuchus was a 7 to 8 meter, 1 to 2 ton monster that lived in Oligocene, Pakistan. Bite marks belonging to a large crocodiloid have been found on juvenile Paraceratherium remains, but we don't know for sure if they were inflicted by Astorgosuchus. Either way, it deserves its own monster movie.
Rhamphosuchus also lived in Pakistan and India, but as a Pleistocene native was later in the timeline. At 8 to 11 meters, it was one of, if not the biggest gharial to ever live, and while narrow, its jaws were quite powerful. It would have been capable of feeding on just about anything it wanted to in its environment, including turtles, fish, and large mammals.
Then there are the Planocranids, a group of crocodilians that wreaked havoc on the land rather than the water. They sported long limbs for fast running, heavy armor, laterally compressed skulls, and teeth that were like theropods. They even had hooves which would serve to increase their speed on land. They lived across Europe and North America, and a study from the year 2000 indicated that they may have even had the ability to gallop. That easily has to be the coolest thing I've heard today. The largest planocranid, Bavurosuchus, was between 2.2 and 3.6 meters long, making it about the size of a small alligator. The group lasted from 61 million to 40 million years ago, terrorizing the Cenozoic for 70 times longer than Homo sapiens have even been around.
Speaking of ancient humans, Crocodilus anthropophagus was a 7-meter behemoth from Pleistocene, Tanzania that ate both Homo habilis and Australopithecus boisei. Specimens of those hominid genera have been found from Olduvai Gorge, where Crocodilus anthropophagus was discovered, with crocodilian bite marks on their bones. Crocodiles are a good way for nature to remind humans that without our tech, we're really not that cool. Further north in Pleistocene, Kenya, we see Crocodilus thorbjörnssoni, an even larger croc that may have also preyed on early humans. A 2012 study gave us this gift of a sentence. This conflict, eat and drink, but maybe die, was presumably foremost amongst the concerns our predecessors felt when approaching ancient waterways inhabited by Crocodilus thorbjörnssoni. If you ever feel like you're having a bad day, remember this. Your ancestors lived in a horror movie.
At least aquatic dryosaurids weren't attacking humans, although they would have munched on any small marine mammals they came across. These crocodilians were slow-growing but extremely fast swimmers and lived all over the world until the late Eocene. The biggest, Phosphatosaurus, was 9 meters or 30 feet long, just casually as long as a big orca. That's just, dandy. But let us take a break from the crocs and look towards the monitor lizards. Varanus priscus, popularly known as Megalania, was a close relative of the Komodo dragon that lived in Australia as recently as 50,000 years ago. It's known for multiple specimens, which are typically between 1.78 and 2.17 meters long, not including the tail. Scaling up from Komodo dragons would yield a typical adult mass of 125 to 228 kilograms. According to a 2004 study, the largest specimen, a vertebrate known from QM2942, scales to an animal 3.8 meters long from snout to vent. That would result in a mass of over 1,200 kilograms. Given the insane size variation within modern Komodo dragons, I personally do not find this difficult to believe at all. Varanus priscus would have eaten giant mammals, like the 3-ton marsupial Diprotodon, and I'm sure he would not have turned down a stray human here and there. It was fairly rare. However, potentially serving as the apex predator, while smaller mammalian hunters like Thylacoleo lived their lives. And we can't forget about Quinkana, which was a 6-meter, possibly terrestrial croc that lived in the same time and place as Megalania. But we did promise to take a break from the crocodiles, so back to you, Vividin.
Here's the Dragon of Utah. Described in an SVP 2024 abstract, this lizard was uncovered in the Uinta Formation of Eocene, Utah, and was estimated by the authors to weigh about 82 kilograms, about the size of an average man. It was twice the size of the largest mammalian carnivores in its environment, and would have taken on prey nearly its own size. I'm so proud of you, Utah. And we can't forget the Harry Potter basilisks, Gigantophis, Titanoboa, and Vasuki. At 7, 12 to 14, and 10 to 15 meters respectively, these serpents lived across the world in Egypt, Colombia, and India. Gigantophis and Vasuki are from the Eocene, with Titanoboa hailing from the Paleocene. Titanoboa weighed at least 700 kilograms, and likely specialized as a semi-aquatic fish hunter, but wouldn't have refused other prey small enough to fit in its gaping jaws. Vasuki was found in a marsh, and may have hunted in the water or on land, perhaps both. Vasuki's environment included early cetaceans, which during this time period would have been the size of large dogs. So yes, if you traveled to Eocene India, you potentially could have seen giant snakes swallowing whales whole.
Reptilian dominance in the Cenozoic was not limited to the classic reptilian build either. Birds, which are a group of theropod dinosaurs, swiftly seized a near monopoly when it comes to flying vertebrates, one only overlapped by bats. Some, like Ornimegalonyx, chose the terrestrial killer build to echo the dominance of the extinct megatheropod cousins. This huge Cuban owl was nearly flightless and was originally mistaken for a terror bird due to its incredible size. Over 3 feet tall, it would have weighed up to 13 kilograms and used its long, strong legs to sprint across the ground in ambushes. Its speed and powerful gripping claws allowed it to prey upon mammals much larger than itself, including capybara-sized hootiers and maybe even 200-kilogram ground sloths. Considering that golden eagles can take down deer, it suddenly doesn't sound like too much of a stretch now, does it?
On to the forest wracids, the actual terror birds. They maintained a foothold in South America for more than 40 million years, with the smallest taxa only going completely extinct about 20,000 years ago. We still don't know what caused them to die out. Competition with saber-toothed cats and other large mammals was suggested, but species like Titanus successfully coexisted with big predatory cats for long periods of time. A fragmentary species described in 2024 from La Venta, Colombia, was scaled by the authors to 156 kilograms, or over 300 pounds. More complete members like Kalenken showed that these animals were tall, extremely fast hunters with powerful beaks and kicks, and ruled the area despite the presence of large mammalian carnivores, the Sporacidonts.
Argentavis is the heaviest flying bird known from the fossil record, at between 70 to 80 kilograms depending on the methods used. This Miocene giant may have fed using a mixture of scavenging and some predation, and at a standing height of nearly 2 meters could have easily scared off competitors from any corpses in the area. The hooked beak may have been an adaptation for ripping through flesh. It's the closest we'll ever get to Token's eagle being a reality.
While much smaller, Haast's eagle was actually from New Zealand. Hyratus morii only went extinct 600 years ago with the arrival of humans, and in the meantime used its claws and 18-kilogram body to take down the much larger moa. A 2021 study found that its skull morphology, combined with Maori cave paintings, indicate it killed its prey with its talons like a huge eagle and then fed like a vulture, burying its head and neck inside open wounds and ripping its victims apart from the inside. Metal. Gigarcanum delcorti probably wasn't the apex predator of New Caledonia 300 years ago, but it was a gecko over half a meter long, which I think is really cool. If a giant gecko doesn't make you happy, I suggest therapy. So yeah, reptiles are awesome. I just wanted to highlight the fact that they filled important, high trophic level niches, even in a time period incorrectly assumed to be a mammalian monopoly. And reptiles still do that today. Saltwater crocodiles are Australia's largest predator. Komodo dragons take on buffalo 10 times their weight and are a threat to humans as well. Big boas and pythons can eat deer. So the next time you see a lizard staring at you from the wall, don't disrespect it because it doesn't live in the Mesozoic. Give it a treat and befriend it, because you never know when the Sebecid Mafia might come knocking at your door. Thanks for watching. I'm a nerd and fantasy author with a biology degree who loves sharing the awesomeness inherent in nature. If the interactions of megafaunal predators are interesting to you, you may enjoy being a part of my newsletter, where you can receive free paleofantasy short stories in the world of Extinction. Extinction is an alternate Earth, where ancient civilizations coexist with prehistoric animals, and humans are born with bonding gems in their foreheads that allow them to psychically communicate with certain types of ancient creatures. Subscribe for more videos like this, and let me know what you'd enjoy seeing more of in the future. I'm the Vividen.
And I'm the Overseer, and we'll see you next time.